Flame Catchers tells the stories of how hosting the Olympic Games sparked defining moments for a nation's sporting culture.
Sydney Olympics really set the tone for me back in 2000 as to something that I really wanted to do, to be an Olympian.
How the Olympic flame lit up new beginnings for a sport, a country.
We just won the first medal in 76 years for our country.
How the legacy of local sports heroes live on to inspire generation after generation.
Once you're an Olympian, you're always going to be an Olympian.
At the dawn of a new millennium, the stage was set. The first Olympic Games within a new century. In a land of profound beauty and mystery, its nation stood up proudly and delivered.
You have presented to the world the best Olympic Games ever.
September 16th, 2000. The opening day of the Games and the day triathlon present itself to the world.
What a performance, ladies and gentlemen. One of the greatest races you've ever seen.
Triathlon made its debut at the Olympic Games in Sydney on the grandest scale. And one of the men who took centre stage for Australia was Miles Stewart.
To be honest, I think in 2000 people probably didn't even realise how big it was until they were actually a part of it all. The place just absolutely erupted, and there were around 350,000 people watching the event. It's the only race that I've ever done in my life where I actually had to cover my ears because the noise was so loud my ears were hurting. It was a magic time, and it was the most watched event in the Olympics that year, so it was an amazing thing to be a part of.
Same weekend, a pint-sized 10-year-old and promising swimmer travelled down with his family from their home in Newcastle for a night at the pool. The young mind began to dream.
It was quite an early morning, but I'd never been so excited to wake up at 5 a.m. in the morning and get the train down to Sydney from Newcastle to watch the event.
We got off the train and there was people from all different countries, and being only 10 years old, I had never experienced such diverse and multicultural people everywhere with their own flags, and it's something that I really treasure. Here we are back at Sydney Olympic Park. It's much quieter than it was that night when I first turned up here back in 2000.
8:16 p.m. The Australian team present themselves to the crowd ahead of the biggest night of their lives.
Michael Treasury, Chris Pfeiffer, Ashley Kellis, and Ian Thorpe, Australia.
I was sitting just up there with my family a couple of rows back. Talking about it now really brings back those memories of what it was like that night.
Australia's hopes rest on the shoulders of 17-year-old Ian Thorpe.
Ian Thorpe was my hero, and he was anchoring the leg against one of the best 100-metre freestyles in Gary Hall Jr.
Take your marks.
The Australians led off really good with Michael Klim. I think he touched down in world record pace in his first 100, and then the other two Australians held their spot, and Ian Thorpe actually dove in with Gary Hall Jr. But Gary Hall put on about a half a body length in front of him by the 50, and the whole crowd sort of held their breath for that first 50 metres, thinking, oh no, the Americans are going to take us. But then as soon as he turned, he made a big gap up on Gary Hall, and literally the roof just started lifting, and people were screaming, and I was standing next to my brother. Both he and I were standing up on the seats, cheering and jumping up and down. And with about 5 metres to go, he got level and then just out-touched him. Everyone was going crazy. We were people that around us we didn't even know. They were hugging each other and high-fiving. And I was only 10, but it was one of the biggest moments in my life.
Even to this day, if I want to try and get some motivation, I go and watch that video on the Olympic YouTube channel just to get that the goosebumps feeling that I got back when I was 10 years old.
That night in 2000, the touch paper was lit. Aaron's aspirations were clear. 10-year-old Aaron was a promising swimmer and cross-country runner, but that wasn't enough. He knew something was missing. And just a few years after triathlon's Olympic debut in Sydney, Wollongong-based coach Jamie Turner identified Aaron's talent.
Aaron was a kid who was doing some swimming and wanted to dip his toe in the water of triathlon. So Aaron came to some camps early on when he was about 13 or 14 years of age. And he was often beating kids that were a lot bigger than him, not through out-muscling them or out-training them, but perhaps just outsmarting them and out-crafting them.
It first started going down in school holidays and just spending some time down there with Jamie and training with the group down there. And then once I finished school, I made the move for good.
At the age of 17, Aaron moved 147 miles from home, all in pursuit of his Olympic dream.
When he first moved away to home to Wollongong, it was a lot of heartache. We spent so much time of our lives taking him to training morning and night. That was our life with both the boys, and it tugged on the heartstrings, and it still does now actually, when he was leaving home. Yeah.
To be honest, I was pretty petrified to make the move at a young age and leave my family and have to do and fight for things myself and not have my mum and dad helping me as much anymore.
But Aaron knew he was joining some of the very best triathletes in the world. The Wollongong Wizards, and a perfect training ground, plus home away from home for an aspiring Olympian.
The Wollongong Wizards are quite a special bunch. They're larrikins, we have a laugh. When we're training in Wollongong, we always meet at Diggies and sit over a nice warm brew or cappuccino before we head out for our day's training.
We just head up north through Puckies, up 20 minutes, and we'll come back 20 minutes for 40 minutes this morning.
Aaron certainly leads without seeming to lead at all, I believe. He does set a standard for performance and he does set a standard for application that I'm sure the other athletes in the group look up to and admire.
Aaron's trained with Jamie the longest here, so Aaron was, I guess, a bit of the leader. Probably not as much as he'd like, but I think we'd all definitely miss him if he wasn't here.
Do you need some tissues? Oh, yeah.
It makes what I do a lot easier to know that there's a supportive group around you. And everyone within the group has their own strengths, and some people have their weaknesses that they're building on, and we all work together to get the best out of each other.
Hours slogging away in training with the Wollongong Wizards was beginning to pay off. And after his first major win on the big stage in Kinloch, New Zealand, Aaron had the belief in himself to win. That belief paid dividends in 2012 as he became under 23 world champion.
It's going to be broken because Aaron Royal from Australia claimed the gold medal.
One of the nicest guys you will meet in the sport. He is a class act. If he can just find that consistency in the future, he is a genuine superstar.
It was a great day, very tough course, and we worked hard on the bike, and thanks to teammate Josh Amberg, who put a lot of work in on the bike for us.
I remembered training for that event and fully believing that I was capable of winning that event, and my parents had come across as well, so that made it extra special.
I went, oh my God, I couldn't believe it. Well, Ken and I were both just, you would not believe, we're like idiots, screaming, jumping up and down, waving our flags.
You look back at Auckland 2012 and you see how that really shaped and gave you belief to be able to go on and then do that at an elite level as well.
Pulling on the green and gold for his country was the distant dream for a wide-eyed 10-year-old that fateful night in the aquatic center. 16 years later, Aaron has fulfilled his dream and become an Olympian. He did it in style when he became Australia's first Olympic qualifier for the Rio Games.
When I qualified for the Olympics, it was something that as a kid I dreamed about all my life, but never a moment actually thought about how it would feel if it actually happened. That's what I go into each race trying to replicate and achieve.
People say to me, I must be very proud. Yeah, we're very proud, but that was a long, long time ago, proudness. It's just so happy for him now that he's achieving what he's worked all those years for.
On your mark.
Sydney 2000 sparked the imagination of many kids like Aaron, and the sport began to grow. Its international appeal is now huge.
The spotlight was on and people were watching, and I think that did breed a generation of kids coming through today. I think it shows them it's possible that they can compete on a world stage, and I think it shows them that triathlon's a sport where they could be successful on the world level.
This is what I dreamed of as a kid, days like this, moments like this, to put on the green and gold in front of my country.
All children dream, don't they? You watch them sitting beside the pool. Oh, I'm going to the Olympics when they're young. But they say it all the time, and then all of a sudden, it's a dream, it's happened, you know? It's just hard to imagine, really, that he's actually achieved it.
For us, it's about growing the grassroots. So having the kids coming through and racing as much as possible and growing up to be triathletes, that's the passion for me, that the young kids coming through got access to really good races and want to make it through the Olympic Games.
The boom or the explosion of triathlon in 2000, certainly it's carried on and it leaves a great legacy. And I think something triathlon does really well whenever it hosts a major event, there's always a legacy left to go back into the community. And I believe it is the responsibility of athletes like Aaron to pass that back to the younger generation.
There's some people in there.
I think that's a fantastic component of our sport, that payback factor.
I'm an athlete that had to work extremely hard to get where I am, and I always try and tell younger kids that I talk to that it doesn't matter how talented you are, that if you put in the hard work and have a goal and something that you want to set in mind, then you can really achieve anything you want to.
September 28th, 2000, 14 days into the Games, and the spotlight was once again on the Sydney Aquatic Centre. It was the final of the women's synchronised diving. Ludie Wiggins, who began her Olympic journey 4 years previously at the Atlanta Games, stepped out onto the platform with her partner Rebecca Gilmore. Their aim? To break the spell of 76 years.
Going into it, Rebecca and I had spoken about winning a medal, but we weren't really sure what to expect.
Australia hadn't won a medal in diving since Dick Eaves struck gold in the 1924 Summer Games.
We knew that it was possible for Australian to get up there. We just didn't know when the moment was going to be. I knew that we needed a big dive, but we tended not to talk before our dives. We were just kind of in sync with each other and just ready for that moment. As soon as we kind of left, I knew that it was good. And we hit the water at the same time. Then I came out, looked at the scoreboards, and once we saw Chava in the barricade of where the coach just sits, he's bawling his eyes out. I realised that we'd won a bronze medal. That was the end for all of us.
Tears of joy and jubilation as 76 years of disappointment were wiped out.
To look at Rebecca and I, we probably weren't the best matched couple. She was a lot taller than I. I probably spun a little bit faster than Rebecca. But somehow we made it work.
Amongst the emotion, it was difficult to comprehend what had just happened.
We couldn't really recognise at that time that we just won the first medal in 76 years for our country. We expected to win a medal, but it's just kind of an emotional relief. Like, finally, someone's won a medal at the Olympic Games for Australia. I don't think Rebecca and I realised at the time, I guess, what an impact winning a medal for diving in Australia had. But in hindsight, it's created somewhat of a snowball effect. I think it was a really important benchmark.
I think the success of us in the diving pool in Sydney certainly got a lot more attention out of the general public. I think it also helped with just talent pipeline and flow of talent into the sport. In particular, as the 2004 Olympics came around, Chantelle Newbury winning the individual women's platform, and then backed up again in 2008 with Matthew Mitchum winning the gold medal in the men's 10 metre platform. That's a real impetus to have, you know, people who are considering diving from adjacent sports like gymnastics. As we saw with Brittany Broben transitioning from not having tried diving in 2008 to being an Olympic medalist 4 years later.
Brittany was just 4 years old when Ludi won bronze in Sydney in 2000. It was therefore fitting that Brittany and Ludi were on the same team 12 years later. For the baby of the Australian team, it was an exciting time.
Not many 16-year-olds can say, like, I went to the Olympics. Like, I would go into the food court and see Usain Bolt, or I'd see Michael Phelps, and I would just be in awe that I was, like, a part of that, and I was one of them now. Like, once you're an Olympian, you're always going to be an Olympian, and to experience that and experience being with all those athletes, I think it's something that I'll always remember. If you watch my last dive, you'll see that I like shake on the platform because I'm just so nervous. It wasn't any more nerve-wracking than the dive before, or the dive before that. Like, it just came down to the last dive. When I looked at the scoreboard and I won silver, it was relief that it was over and I had done it, and I had, like, all my hard work had paid off.
Hard work was reflected in the Broben family, particularly mum Janine, who showed tireless dedication to Britain's Olympic dream.
I wouldn't have made it to the Olympics if it wasn't for my mum. My mum would wake me up at 4:30 every morning and would drive me to Brisbane. I'd train 6 till 8. And then my mum would drive me back to school to the Gold Coast, which is an hour away, and drive me back up to Brisbane for a 2:30 till 6 o'clock session, and then drive me back home. So we were in the car for more than 4 hours a day, 6 days a week.
The silver medalist representing Australia, Brittany
Seeing my mum cry, it shows how much she loves me and how much she was genuinely just happy for me. She saw all the blood, sweat and tears that went into diving and what I went through, and I'll always remember it.
Brittany is a product of Diving Australia's resurgence in the Olympic medal tables, which all began with Ludi Wiggins back in 2000. But Ludi actually began her career 4 years earlier in Atlanta, when she was just 17.
Ludi and I did figure out I was, like, only 8 months old when she competed at her first Olympics. Not many people can say that they competed at the Olympics when I was, like, 8 months old, and then they're on the team with me, like, 16 years later. So, I mean, it was pretty crazy and just an incredible experience to be on the team with her.
With a career spanning the course of 4 Olympic Games, it's easy to see why Ludi is such an inspiration.
Ludi, to me, is an amazing athlete. I mean, even to see her come back in 2012, and she was double my age, so there was the youngest on the team and the oldest on the team, and I mean, to be able to do what she did and make that comeback, she's just an amazing athlete, an amazing diver, and I definitely look up to her.
Brittany's career was just beginning in 2012, but for Ludi, it was nearing its end.
Life post-Olympics is quite hectic. I've realised that I really don't need a lot of downtime like I did when I was an athlete, so I'm definitely a million miles an hour, but I function better that way, and I love having new ideas and creating new goals for myself, because as an athlete or ex-athlete, you know, you really need that in your life.
Ludi now lives in Melbourne, Australia, with her husband Simon and two children, Layla and Alexander. Her Olympic spirit is kept alive in a number of ways.
My personal training business started after the 2012 Olympic Games. I had it in the wheels in motion to start getting clients, and very, very quickly I was capped for clients. I no longer can take new clients, and I think that's great, especially when I was starting out from scratch. Health and well-being has always been instilled in me as a very small girl, so I'm glad that I can share that with other people. So I'm just going to walk you through to the gym where I do most of my personal training workouts. I used to hate doing weights when I was a diver. I just have to look at a weight and I would get quite bulky. So I've found it quite surprising that I love doing weights now. Good, and open up your chest. That's it, and six more. Perfect. Excellent, keep pushing.
As a mother of two, Ludi is keen to instill Olympic values into her children's lives. Her firstborn, Layla, inspired her comeback in 2012 and is now beginning her own journey in the world of sport.
What Simon and I want for Layla, I guess, is just for her to enjoy sport. We both come from sporting backgrounds, so we believe that sport teaches you things like respect, hard work, teamwork, and it just sets you up for really good habits for life.
Ludi's pathway to success began in gymnastics. Now Layla is following in her footsteps.
Are you going to wear your favourite leotard in the whole wide world? Yes. What do you like about gymnastics? What about
somersaults?
Somersaults. When Layla started her first gymnastics lesson, I was in the corner kind of having a little teary, because I remember my first day so quickly, and just seeing her enjoy the sport, running around, being confident with other kids was fantastic. She started about 6 months ago at the exact same age that I started gymnastics. It's hard for me not to get excited about that, but it brings back a lot of old memories, and I just really want her to enjoy it. So I don't often get the medals out. They just live in the house, kind of hidden away, but I guess it's nice, and one day, hopefully, my kids will appreciate it. And it is definitely nice to see them with them. So this one, Layla, is from Athens in Greece before you were born. And Layla, this is also from the Olympic Games.
Oh.
Ooh. They're very, very special to me and very important, but obviously these ones are important too, so. I think that it's great that in diving now in Australia that they've got a lot of different role models to look up to, and it's been for a few generations now, so that culture of success is quite important, and no matter who enters the sport, I guess they'll expect to do well, which is really important going into competitions.
Sydney's Olympic flame continues to be passed on. The games where some became heroes.
The Sydney Olympic Games were an incredible experience. I just don't think I wiped the smile off my face for a very long time.
Others were taught to surpass expectations.
I think Australia was just shocked that I got a medal. I was the baby. I wasn't expected to do anything.
and inspire generations for years to come.
I'm just doing what I love, being a triathlete, but I get letters from young kids sometimes saying how I've inspired them, and to be honest, it inspires me.